My name is Fraser Burling. I'm a dual-trained physician and rheumatologist, and I work at the Rheumatology and Musculoskeletal Clinic at Auckland. We had two patients come to the clinic with Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome, one of which was Tracey. And treating them for their soft tissue injuries with prolotherapy, which is a process of strengthening damaged ligaments, resulted in significant improvements in those two. This ribbon represents the zebra, which is the mascot for Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. First reason is if you hear galloping hooves, don't automatically think horses. The second reason is the clinical expression for Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is as varied as the stripes of a zebra, and no two zebras have the same stripes. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is a collection of conditions of abnormal collagen synthesis, whether it be the collagen molecules themselves or the molecules that help put collagen together. We currently have 30 known genes for Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. So Ehlers-Danlos syndrome being about collagen synthesis, collagen holds everything together in your body, not just joints and bones, but it also holds together the soft tissues such as your muscles, your blood vessels, your internal organs, and in fact, pretty much everything in the body is held together by collagen. So when you have abnormalities within Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, it's not just the musculoskeletal abnormalities such as being able to put your thumb through to the wrist or being able to bring this little finger back to the midway or stretching the arm back past 180 degrees, which is where you see with part of the Batten score, but it is also about the skin pulling back further in many people with the classical types. It is about people dropping their blood pressure on standing because the vessels in their legs can't push the blood back up properly. It's about trouble with swallowing food for some people, with digesting food for some people, with pushing the food out through the back passage so that people can be constipated for up to 6 weeks at a time without a bowel motion. It really affects multiple different aspects of the body. We then look at multiple other issues that are involved. So I actually have a whole checklist page that I go through. So asking things like, were you able to do party tricks when you were younger? So these include the ability to do the prayer hands behind your back. Some people could put their foot over their head. Many people could do the splits without having to work towards doing that. People would often show off to their classmates in school about bending their fingers back or bending part of the finger so they'd be able to do sort of that motion with their finger without any effort at all. Then there were those who would actually pull on their skin and pull it out. Then there are the histories such as whether they bruise easily or not, whether they feel faint or dizzy on standing. Some subtypes have a marfanoid habitus, which means that they have extra long fingers, extra long toes, extra long limbs compared to the height. When you're looking at the classical phenotypes of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, it was a long time ago thought to be 1 in 75,000 to 1 in 150,000. Then it was brought down to 1 in 10,000. More recent literature has put it in 1 in 5,000, and very modern literature is putting it more like 1 in 2,500. And it may end up being closer to 1 in 1,000. We don't know yet. I think it's been more an issue of it being underdiagnosed rather than not existent. The fact that we have multiple issues that are now recognized and multiple treatment options that are also recognized and are able to be applied to patients so that they no longer have to live in chronic pain, and many of them can be made pain-free. So, for example, I had one patient who took 10 minutes just to get out of a car, and then 2 years later was able to climb a mountain overseas. And she was able to do that because of the fact that we'd got her through the pathway with a multidisciplinary team approach and got her back to living a normal life again. Now, this isn't a one-off. Many of our patients come to us on the verge of suicide because their life has been destroyed by injuries. Now let me make it clear here, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome does not cause injury. Accidents cause injury, but people with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome are more easily injured when they have an accident, and they're harder to heal. And so by the process of a multidisciplinary team approach, working together, we've got many people back to living a normal life again, or as near normal as we can get them, but significantly improved from where they used to be. We're getting a lot more treatment available for patients that I can certainly that I could provide. And as we get cardiologists and gastroenterologists and other rheumatologists recognizing and being able to treat the condition, it really makes a difference to first people being recognized as having the condition and getting a diagnosis, and secondly, people getting appropriate treatment that can be life-saving. The way forward for New Zealand for Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is more recognition nationally. The Ministry of Health, in combination with the Rare Diseases Organisation, set up a committee of which I was a member to write a pathway for Ehlers-Danlos syndrome for both recognition and simple treatment options. This pathway is now present in one DHB, and we'd really like to see it in all DHBs. We'd like more recognition amongst colleagues of the various issues that are associated with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. In Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, psychological issues are common. However, they are commonly secondary rather than primary. So if someone is living in chronic pain, it is a major depressant. It can also cause significant anxiety, especially if it affects the person's ability to earn an income. We do have a lot of help from psychologists and psychiatrists in this field, especially when someone first comes to us in the suicidal state. And while we're dealing with many of their medical issues, we need the psychological help to deal with those psychological issues at the same time. The key is that once you deal with the medical issues, the psychological issues lift, and lift dramatically. And so people who have been suicidal when they first come to the clinic, as we sort through their issues, they find that life is worth living again, especially if they're not longer living in chronic pain anymore, or if they're able to eat again food that they weren't able to eat before. So the process of building a person back up from a state of injury can take much longer to achieve than someone without Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, for example. And this can be not just because of the soft tissue injuries or the ligament damage or dislocating joints, but can also be because of other factors in their life that are affected and other organ systems that are affected. We do use the strong agents, which are tetradecyl sulfate and polidocanol, which have been used in varicose veins for decades, and they've been used in soft tissue injuries for about 20 years internationally. These agents are much stronger than dextrose, we found, and so we gave up on dextrose at a clinic many, many years ago. However, they help the body lay down soft tissue, build up the tissue, and actually stop people dislocating joints. And we even published on that in January of this year in the British Medical Journal group. And that's an open source paper as well, if people wish to look it up.